Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Hello, I'm Brian Tracy, and welcome to Victory, applying the proven principles of military strategy to achieve greater success in your business and personal life. Preface. From the time I was 15 years old, I've been fascinated by the military commanders who were able to achieve astounding victories against great odds, often far from home. There was even a rumor that Napoleon Bonaparte carried a copy of The Art of War by Sun Tzu on his campaigns, and that this book was the secret to his successes in battle, making him one of the greatest generals in history. In working with hundreds of companies and thousands of executives and entrepreneurs, I found that exceptionally successful men and women often have qualities similar to those of the great military leaders throughout the ages. Like generals commanding armies, they also use proven and practical principles to achieve success against great odds and to achieve far more than those who do not know and apply these principles. Results are the measure of effectiveness, but results alone are not enough. They must be attained in a timely fashion. Time is precious. It is invaluable, indispensable, irreplaceable, and necessary. It is the stuff of life and must be husbanded and used with great care. The purpose of this book is to introduce you to many of the same ideas and strategies used by the most effective men and women in every field, and to give you specific tools you can use to achieve victory in your personal and business life. Just as the commander with the best soldiers, armaments, and materiel has a decided advantage over the opposing force, the individual who has the greatest arsenal of thinking tools will win out over the competition time and time again. My goal for you in writing this book is to save you an enormous amount of time in achieving your most important goals. In the pages ahead, I will present you with military principles and give you some of the best thinking tools ever discovered for achieving great success. You will then have them for the rest of your life, and you can use them to attain victory in everything you do far faster than you ever would without them. Introduction. Once upon a time, a young man from the Midwest was living in New York in a boarding house and working at a low-level job in a large company. He had come from an average background and had only a high school education. He had little confidence in himself or in his long-term ability to accomplish very much in life. For almost 3 years, he got up in the morning, went to work, did his job, socialized with his few friends, and just accepted that this is the way things were supposed to be. One day, an elderly stranger moved into the boarding house. The older man had traveled widely and claimed not only to be able to tell fortunes, but also to tell people who they had been in their previous lives. The young man and the stranger met and spoke regularly as they came and went to and from their daily routines. One day, the stranger sat down with the young man and told him that he had had a revelation about the young man's previous life, and that about these things he was never wrong. He told the young man that in a previous life he had been Napoleon Bonaparte. He had been one of the great statesmen, generals, and leaders of history. As Napoleon Bonaparte, he had risen from humble beginnings on the island of Corsica, developed himself through hard work and application, become an officer in the French army, and eventually had risen to become Emperor of France. The older man seemed to know of the young man's life as Napoleon in great detail. He went on to tell him that Napoleon Bonaparte had led his armies in hundreds of battles all over Europe and Egypt and had achieved incredible victories against overwhelming odds. He had completely transformed the government of France and gone down in history as one of the greatest leaders of all time. The young man, of course, was extremely skeptical. He didn't really believe the stranger, even though he was flattered and intrigued by the idea of having been powerful and famous in a previous life. But as the weeks went by, the boarder kept adding new details about the young man's life as Napoleon Bonaparte and his qualities of leadership, character, and personality. Eventually, the stranger's wealth of detail and absolute conviction that the young man had actually been Napoleon in a previous life convinced the young man that the story was indeed true. From that point forward, the young man began looking into himself for any indication that he might have the qualities of a great leader. He began to study the life and exploits of Napoleon. The more he studied Napoleon and the qualities of leadership, generalship, and the power of command Napoleon exerted over his armies, the more the young man noticed that he also had the same qualities deep within himself. He began to study other generals as well. He studied military history. He studied books on leadership, both in business and in warfare. Repeatedly, he noticed occasions when he exhibited many of the same qualities that leaders everywhere had demonstrated throughout history. And the more he thought about these qualities, the more he began to walk and talk like a leader in his work. He volunteered for assignments and took on additional responsibilities. He spent his spare time studying and upgrading his skills. He took the initiative to solve problems, make decisions, and get things done at his company. He held nothing back. Bit by bit, his fears and doubts were replaced by confidence and courage. His superiors noticed the changes in the young man. They began to give him tasks and responsibilities commensurate with his increasing competence. Each time he was given something more to do, the young man embraced the opportunity and threw himself wholeheartedly into doing the job in an excellent fashion. As a result, he became more knowledgeable and experienced. He was soon paid more and promoted repeatedly. By the time he was 30, he was a different person than when he had moved from the Midwest. He had completely transformed from a shy young man to a bold, confident executive. He made ever greater and more important contributions to his company. Eventually, he rose to the top of his field and became a leading figure in his industry. Pushing to the front. Whether or not this story is true doesn't matter. The lesson of the story is this. If you think and act like a leader, if you learn the qualities and behaviors of great leaders, and you apply them in your daily life, you will inevitably evolve and mature into a leadership position in whatever you do. By taking complete charge of your life and your future, you will put yourself onto the fast track in your career. Throughout history, some of the finest examples of leadership have been shown by generals who achieved victory in chaotic situations, often against great odds. Often the decision of a single officer at one critical moment has decided the outcome of a battle and even the fate of an empire. The incredible stress and confusion of a clash of armies often brings out the very best in a person. Modern life is a battle as well. You are constantly competing in your work and business against uncertain forces in a turbulent environment. You face a never-ending succession of problems and crises. And while soldiers only fight in a few battles during their lifetimes, your battles never end. Our uncertain world needs leaders now more than any other time in history. There is perhaps no better decision that you can make than to be a leader in your work, your family, your community, and your personal life. Your job is to step forward and take command. Your job is to accept responsibility and get things done. Your success in life is largely determined by your ability to get results, to follow through in the face of adversity. The more difficult, the more important the results you achieve, the greater the glory and rewards you receive for achieving them. The quality of your life is determined by the quality of your thinking. The better you think, the better results you get. The more you identify with and emulate leaders, both past and present, the more you become like them. The more you think like a leader, the more you take the actions that leaders take, and the more you get the results that leaders get. Military leaders over the centuries. Over the centuries, we have studied great military leaders and analyzed their battles. Thousands of historians and researchers have devoted themselves to finding the common denominators of victory or defeat in warfare. They have concluded that successful commanders win largely because of boldness, speed, surprise, and resolute determination to achieve victory. From the days of Thucydides and his History of the Peloponnesian War, the core principles of military strategy have been identified. These principles have then been taught to subsequent generations of officers in the armed services and military schools worldwide. There are 12 basic principles of military strategy, which are necessary to assure victory and to avoid defeat. Each one of these principles by itself has been responsible for victories or defeats. Each of them is as applicable to business and personal success as to warfare. These 12 principles, around which this book is written, are the principles of the objective, the offensive, the mass, maneuver, intelligence, concerted action, unity of command, simplicity, security, economy, surprise, and exploitation. In a tight contest, violation of any one of these principles can lead to defeat. Your goal as an entrepreneur, executive, sales professional, parent, employee, committee member, whatever you endeavor, is to learn and practice these principles in your business. This book will show you how you can apply each one of these strategic thinking concepts to getting better results, faster, perhaps than you ever imagined possible. They will show you how to achieve victory. The use of force multipliers. The 12 principles of military strategy explain most victories and every defeat, success, or failure on the battlefield or in business or personal life. In addition, there are force multipliers, which can dramatically change the odds and improve the likelihood of victory or success in any competitive situation. A force multiplier enables a smaller force to increase its hitting power and impact at a critical point where victory is possible. By applying one or more force multipliers to your situation, you can gain an advantage that enables you to defeat your enemy or outperform your competition. Some of these force multipliers are superior knowledge, greater skill, optimism, confidence, high morale, creativity and innovation, the ability to focus and concentrate on key targets and objectives, strategic alliances, excellent relationships with key people and organizations, excellent communications among all people involved, superior leadership at all levels. These are all factors that you can develop and apply to your business and personal life. How many of them do you use already? Your future is unlimited. Each of the principles of military strategy can be learned, and each of the force multipliers can be developed, thereby enabling you to multiply your own effectiveness and that of your organization. Just as young officers are taught to think and take actions consistent with these principles and force multipliers in the various military academies, you can learn and practice these principles in the rough and tumble of daily life. In your personal and work life, the stakes may not be as high as they are on the battlefield, where life and death hangs in the balance. Nevertheless, men and women who achieve great things are those who take their responsibilities and their situations seriously. They leave nothing to chance. They study and prepare themselves so that they are ready to perform consistently well in the critical battles and key moments of life and work. Your goal is not just to make a living, but also to make a great life. Your goal is to fulfill your potential as a person in every area, and to become everything that you are capable of becoming over the course of your life and career. As the Army recruiting poster says, be all that you can be. And to paraphrase famous Green Bay Packers coach Vince Lombardi, winning is not a one-time thing, it's an all-the-time thing. The great mistake that most people make is not realizing one key point. The failure to commit to excellence, to victory, leads by default to the subconscious acceptance of mediocrity and eventual defeat. This book is written for the ambitious, energetic, determined, success-oriented individual, from executives, entrepreneurs, professionals, and other business leaders, to leaders of all descriptions in all walks of life who are absolutely determined to win big in life and work. In the pages ahead, you will learn how to apply each of these key military principles of strategy in everything you do. You will learn how to think and plan strategically, focus and concentrate your talents and resources, take advantage of opportunities, protect against setbacks, work more effectively with others, and maximize all your abilities to achieve extraordinary success. You will learn how to achieve personal victory in whatever you choose. You will learn how to win the key battles, the ones that really matter. You will learn how to accomplish more in the next couple of years than most people accomplish in a lifetime of work. Let's begin. Chapter 1. The Principle of the Objective. Clarity is essential. Pursue one great decisive aim with force and determination. Major General Karl von Clausewitz. In every war, every battle, every great human endeavor, there must be clear, specific goals and objectives. Each person who is responsible for a part of the result must know exactly what that result is and how it is to be measured. The greater the degree of clarity, the more likely it is that the goal will be achieved. The Battle of Arbela. On the 1st of October in 331 BC, a battle between the veteran, well-rested troops of Alexander and the tired soldiers of King Darius III would decide the fate of an empire. Alexander had allowed some of his scouts to be captured and interrogated. They told Darius III Alexander was preparing a night attack. Darius therefore kept his entire army awake and in full battle formation all night. To reinforce this perception, Alexander sent light skirmishing forces in a series of quick attacks on the flanks of the Persian army, darting in and out throughout the night. On the other side of the plain of Gaugamela, near the town of Arbela on the Tigris in Assyria, the Macedonian army had retired early and slept well. The fatigue of the Persians was, however, only one factor that Alexander counted on for victory. The Persian army definitely had the advantage in the sense that they outnumbered Alexander's army. From the numerous accounts of this battle by ancient Greek historians such as Arrian and from Plutarch's Life of Alexander the Great, we know that the strength of the Persian army was about 200,000 men. Alexander had an army of less than 50,000 infantry and cavalry under his command. The Persians would only have to extend their front and sweep around both flanks to crush the Macedonians once and for all. Alexander had already defeated them in two previous battles, and the Persians were eager for revenge. When the sun rose on the plain of Gaugamela, the entire Macedonian army was drawn up at an oblique angle, with cavalry at either end of the formation, and with the heavy infantry, the phalanx, the shield-bearers, and the hoplites in formation in the center. As always, Alexander rode his great black warhorse Bucephalus and wore a shiny jewel-encrusted helmet above a flowing red cape so that everyone in his army and in the enemy army could see him clearly. Darius launched his assault on the outnumbered Macedonians by sending forward his 300 battle chariots with razor-like scythes spinning on the axles. Alexander had anticipated this initial assault and immediately ordered his javelin throwers forward to hurl wave after wave of deadly accurate javelins into the oncoming horses and men. The chariots, horses, and riders were torn to pieces by the oncoming missiles and were quickly eliminated as an effective fighting force. Meanwhile, the cavalry on either flank of Darius' army attacked the right and left flanks of the Macedonian army. A bitter fight ensued, but the well-disciplined Macedonian center held firm and began moving right toward the left flank of the Persian army. As the Persian front shifted sideways to counter the movement of the Macedonians, a hole opened up in the center of the Persian line. Alexander, seeing his opportunity, gave a loud battle cry and with his companion guard of elite cavalry, pursued Darius himself. Alexander led the attack. His men, the finest cavalry in the world, hurled after him. They carved through the front of the Persian line like a knife through butter, heading directly toward Darius' command post in the center of the army. Alexander's objective was clear from the beginning. He knew that the Persian army was made up of conscripted troops from all over the empire. They were not loyal to each other. They were only loyal to Darius, the king. Alexander was certain that if he could kill Darius or drive him from the field, the remaining troops would not stand and fight for each other. Alexander's military philosophy was that the opposing general in command was the linchpin that held the enemy army together. He planned each battle to create an opportunity where he could launch his elite cavalry, like a spear, at the enemy general in the middle of the army. In every case, when the enemy general was killed or driven to flight, the rest of the army would lose its cohesion and begin to disintegrate. Victory quickly followed. As Alexander and his elite cavalry formed a wedge that cut through the front of the Persian army toward Darius. The king lost his nerve, leaped on a horse, and fled from the battlefield. His subordinate generals immediately jumped on their horses and followed him. The word traveled like wildfire throughout the Persian army. The Macedonians are in the center, and Darius has fled. The battle must be lost. Run for it. Without leadership, the army started to come apart. There were 2 more hours of bitter fighting between the Persians and Macedonian cavalry on the flanks and the Persian and Macedonian troops in the center, but the Macedonians under Alexander prevailed. It was a defeat, then a rout, then a slaughter. By the end of the day, the Persians are believed to have lost about 90,000 men. The Macedonian dead numbered only about 500. This victory made Alexander the master of Persia, at the time the greatest empire in the world. He was 25 years old. Alexander was perhaps the greatest military commander in history, a leader who was never defeated on the battlefield. One of the reasons for his successes was his absolute clarity about the objective to be achieved in each battle. The principle of the objective: direct all efforts toward a clearly defined, decisive, and attainable objective. The ultimate goal of war is the fulfillment of the policy for which the war is being fought. The accomplishment of this goal often requires the defeat of the enemy's armed forces and of the destruction of his means or will to resist. The principle of the objective is applicable at all echelons. Goals of smaller units are frequently altered in campaigns and wars, but seldom in the midst of battle. Make it clear and simple. When General Dwight D. Eisenhower was sent by General George C. Marshall to take command of the Allied forces in London in World War II, his orders and his objective were clear. Proceed to London, invade Europe, defeat the Germans. When General Norman Schwarzkopf was dispatched to command the Allied forces against Iraq in the Gulf War in 1991, his orders were also clear. Get the Iraqi army out of Kuwait. The air forces that provided cover to the army in the Gulf had a single objective with regard to the Iraqi air force. If it flies, it dies. In warfare, as in all areas of life, the objective must have 5 qualities. 1. Clear. The objective must be absolutely clear to all those who are expected to be instrumental in attaining it. When the goal is to seize a specific objective, each person responsible must know what the objective is, where it is, and when it is to be seized. 2. Attainable. The objective should be realistic and within the span of control of the unit to which it is assigned. The goal should not require superhuman strengths or abilities, and it must be attainable with the resources of the unit assigned to that goal. 3. Decisive. The objective must be significant and meaningful, and must make a worthwhile contribution to the achievement of higher order objectives. Lives should not be risked to attain an objective that is not essential to the success of the overall campaign. 4. Specific. The objective should be measurable. It should be expressed in such a way that it is clear whether or not it has been accomplished. A third party should be able to judge whether or not the objective has been attained. 5. Time-bounded. There must be a specific deadline along with timelines for the achievement of the objective. A specific date and time must be given for the attainment of a clear, decisive, and specific objective. Clear objectives, backed by detailed plans, vigorously executed with boldness and persistence, lead to success time and time again. Unclear or fuzzy objectives, often accompanied by confusing or contradictory plans, lead to underachievement and defeat over and over. The principle of the objective in business. The same principles that apply to the achievement of military battle objectives also apply to the achievement of business goals in competitive markets. You must know exactly how much of what product or service is to be sold, by whom, at what price, to which customer group, and how it is to be paid for, produced, and delivered. In every case, the most important word is clarity. The greater your clarity regarding exactly what it is you are trying to accomplish, the greater the likelihood that you will achieve it on schedule. Strategic planning in warfare is analogous to strategic business planning and to personal strategic planning. Success in any area of life is a direct result of knowing exactly what you want and then determining the very best way to achieve it. When you have a clear target to aim at and you have carefully planned every step of the way to your goal, you will accomplish vastly more in a shorter period of time than if you started off without a clear strategic plan. Almost everything we talk about in this book can be used in either area of your life to increase your effectiveness and to improve the quality and quantity of the results that you accomplish. Idealization. Begin setting objectives for your business or your company's business by projecting forward 3 to 5 years and imagining a perfect future. Decide what is right before you decide what is possible. If the business were ideal in every respect 5 years from today, what would it look like? Imagine that you could wave a magic wand and create the perfect situation in every part of the company. Imagine that you have all the money, manpower, and resources to do anything you want in your organization. If the business were perfect in 5 years, what would be its level of sales, profitability, and reputation in the marketplace? How much would your company be earning? And what would your personal income be? All business planning begins with an ideal vision of the future. Clarifying and sharing this vision is a key responsibility of leadership. As the Bible says, where there is no vision, the people perish. Where there is no vision in a company, people are eventually reduced to simply going through the motions, operating from day to day with no idea of the kind of future they are supposed to be creating. Company objectives. The purpose of a business strategy is to provide a plan to organize and deploy the resources of the business in such a way as to increase the return on equity invested in the business. This is the amount of money that the owners of the business have put at risk to earn a profit. The second aim of business strategy is to decrease costs by finding better, faster, cheaper ways to produce the same products or services and accomplish the same results. The third objective of business strategy is to identify and exploit the opportunities of tomorrow while simultaneously reducing the risks of today. There are four key questions with regard to setting objectives that you should ask and answer continually, especially when you are experiencing resistance or frustration of any kind in the accomplishment of your goals. These questions are: 1. What are we trying to do? What exactly are your goals? Are they written down, clear, specific, time-bounded, and measurable? Lack of clarity with regard to goals leads to lack of accomplishment, both in the short term and in the long term. 2. How are we trying to do it? Always remain open to the possibility that there could be a different or better way to accomplish the same objective, with lower costs, lower risks, and greater certainty. 3. What are our assumptions? What are you assuming about your current situation that may not be true at all? Every decision is made on the basis of certain assumptions, either clear or unclear. As Alex McKenzie, author of The Time Trap, wrote, errant assumptions lie at the root of every failure. For example, in World War II, the fortress of Singapore was supposedly impregnable, but the British defenders assumed that any attack on Singapore would come from the sea. When the Japanese instead attacked from the landward side to the north, the British were quickly overwhelmed and surrendered a garrison of 62,000 men on February 15, 1942. Winston Churchill described it as the worst disaster and largest capitulation in British history. 4. What if our assumptions are wrong? What if you are taking actions today that would be completely inappropriate for achieving your objectives if certain assumptions were wrong? Always be open to the possibility that you are dead wrong in your beliefs and assumptions. If you were wrong, what changes would you have to make immediately to survive and thrive in your current market? The GOSPA model of strategic planning. There's a simple 5-step formula that you can use for establishing clear objectives and for strategic planning for the rest of your career. As regularly as breathing in and breathing out, you should practice these 5 principles in every part of your business. 1. The first letter, G, stands for goals. Goals in business represent the final financial results that you want to achieve. All business goals can be described in financial terms. Your goals must be clear, written, and specific. They must be measurable and exact. They must be time-bounded with deadlines. Some examples of financial goals are sales volume, net profit, return on equity, return on investment, return on sales, growth rate, market share, and profit per customer. Which numbers you choose to zero in on largely determines how you will organize and deploy the people and resources of your business. Step 2, the second letter, O, stands for objectives. In this case, your objectives are the sub-goals that you must accomplish to achieve your larger final goals. Some of the sub-goals that you will have to accomplish before you can achieve your larger goals of profitability and return on investment are the following. 1. You must obtain, organize, and deploy the necessary financial resources to build and maintain your business operation. 2. You must acquire, train, manage, and motivate the appropriate people to do the job and carry out the work. 3. You will have to advertise, promote, market, and sell a specific volume of products or services within a specific time, at specific prices, yielding specific levels of profit. 4. Once you have accomplished the first three goals, you will have to produce, manufacture, distribute, and deliver the products and services that you have sold. 5. You will have to organize the logistical and administrative details of the business in order to handle the information, paperwork, processing, and other activities that underpin all successful business enterprise. Once your goals and objectives are clear to you and to everyone you depend on to carry them out, you can move on to step 3 in the GOSPA model. Step 3, the third letter, S, stands for strategies. These are the different approaches or ways that you can go about achieving your goals and objectives. To get from point A to point B, there are many different routes you can follow. Your choice of an appropriate strategy will largely determine whether or not you succeed or fail. The choice of the correct strategy is therefore vitally important. Begin by asking this question. What are all the different ways that we can accomplish this goal? Remember, a goal not yet achieved is merely a problem not yet solved. Approach the attainment of a goal or an objective as you would seek the solution to a problem. For example, Alexander approached his battles by answering the question, "How can I undermine the objectives and morale of the enemy's army?" He succeeded by making the enemy believe its goal was unattainable. Remain open to different and unusual solutions. Beware of any goal or objective for which there is only one possible strategy. Beware of any problem for which there is only one solution. Beware of any question for which there is only one answer. Continue asking the question, what else could be the answer? Before you finalize a strategy, you should have a variety of potential strategies available to you. This requires the hard work of thinking and is the key responsibility of the leader and the decision maker. Once you have developed a series of possible strategies or approaches to achieving your goal or solving your problem, you should evaluate each of these options based on the following factors. 1, what are your capabilities? Just because you want to do something does not mean that you are capable of doing it. Desire and enthusiasm are wonderful qualities, but they do not translate into effective results unless they are accompanied by core competencies and capabilities. In Jim Collins' 2001 book, From Good to Great, he makes the key point that the great companies are those that put the right people in place in the key positions before they make any final decisions about goals, objectives, and strategy. Do you have the people you need? Can you get them? The most effective fighting forces have the best trained and most aggressive officers at all levels. 2. Do you have the resources, both internal and external, to carry out a particular strategy? General Bernard Law Montgomery, known as Martini Montgomery, was obsessive about having far greater supplies of weapons, armament, and materiel than he would need before launching a major attack against the enemy. This was the key to his victory at El Alamein over Field Marshal Erwin Rommel in 1942. Do you have the necessary financial resources? Do you have the necessary contacts and alliances in the marketplace? Do you have the necessary knowledge, skill, and experience to carry out a particular strategy? If not, can you acquire them? If you cannot get them, what would be an alternative strategy that is more consistent with the resources that you have available? These are key questions that you must ask and answer before you commit to a particular course of action. Question 3. What is the situation in the marketplace today? Are sales for your product or service strong or weak? Are sales growing or declining? Are the trends in your market moving in your favor and boosting your sales and profitability? Or are the trends moving against you? A good leader is very sensitive to the nuances of the environment and is constantly testing his assumptions about the state of business as it actually exists today. Question 4. Who is your competition, and how are they likely to react to any strategy of yours? In Michael Porter's book, Competitive Advantage, he emphasizes the importance of considering the responses of your competitors to any action you take in the market. There is a military axiom that says, "No strategy ever survives first contact with the enemy." You must carefully plan every possible detail of your strategy and logistics, but you must be prepared to modify your strategy quickly in response to unexpected actions taken by your competitors to defend their markets or to seize yours. Whatever your strategy, you should assume that your competitors will move to counteract it in some way. The more successful you are with your strategy in making sales and taking market share, the more vigorously and aggressively your competitors will move to either copy your strategy or undermine your perceived strengths. Therefore, whatever strategy you decide upon, keep your plans to yourself as long as possible. When you do launch, aim to get there firstest with the mostest, so that you can achieve maximum results before your competition reacts. Count Otto von Bismarck, the Iron Chancellor of Germany, was considered to be the foremost diplomat and statesman of his time. He was famous for always having a plan B, a Bismarck plan, in his drawer. This was his fallback plan in case his first plan did not work. No matter what happened, no matter what reverses he experienced at the great councils of Europe, he was always ready to bounce back with a well-developed and well-thought-out alternative plan. You should do the same. Once you have decided upon a particular strategy, you should immediately develop an alternative strategy, just in case the first strategy doesn't work. Having an alternative plan to fall back on gives you a greater sense of confidence, courage, and boldness in executing your original plan. It is a powerful psychological factor that you should use to your advantage. Step 4, the fourth letter in GOSPA, P, stands for plans. Your plans are the rungs on the ladder from where you are to wherever it is you want to go. The planning stage is where the rubber meets the road. This is the real key to your success. As Patton said, take plenty of time to set up an attack. It takes at least 2 hours to prepare an infantry battalion to execute a properly coordinated attack. Shoving them in too soon produces useless losses. In war, nothing is achieved by calculation. Everything that is not soundly planned in its details yields no results. Begin the planning process by making a list of every single thing that you will have to do to achieve your goal or objective. Leave nothing out. Be as detailed as you can. When you think of a new task or activity, write it down on the list. Keep working on this list until it is complete in every detail and describes the process of achievement from the first step to the final victory. Next, make a list of everything that you will need in order to carry out every activity in your plan. List the people, knowledge, and skills that you will require. List the furniture, fixtures, and facilities that you will need. List the financial resources that will be necessary. Remember, the devil is in the details. The most effective leaders, like the most effective military commanders, are those who think through every detail in advance and never trust to luck for anything. Once you have your list of activities and resources, organize these lists in two ways. 1. Organize your activities by priority. Which items are more important and which items are less important? Use the 80-20 rule. What are the 20% of your activities that will account for 80% of the value of all of your activities? Use the ABC method of setting priorities. A priorities are very important. There are serious consequences if they are not done in a timely fashion. B activities are those that should be done but are not as important as A activities. C activities are things that would be nice to do, but they are not as important as A or B activities. Your ability to analyze your list of activities and assign correct priorities to them is a critical skill of both success and leadership. It is often the determining factor between success and failure. Number two, organize your list in terms of the time at which the tasks must be completed. Something may be very important, a top priority, but it may not be required for several weeks or months. Every activity has a specific time-date requirement. Each of these tasks should be in order and then combined with your priorities to create your finished plan. Determine which activities are parallel and can be done simultaneously with other activities. Many things can be done at the same time at which other things are being done. You can dramatically increase the speed at which you accomplish a goal by having several people or organizations working on different parts of the business. When World War II began, the U.S. Navy was woefully short of ships to transport men and supplies to Britain. Henry J. Kaiser was assigned by the War Department to build Liberty ships as quickly as possible to replace the large number of ships that were being sunk by the German U-boats. Benjamin Trigo said, "The very worst use of time is to do something well that need not be done at all." When Kaiser took over, he was taking 2 years to build and launch a single ship. Within a year, he had reduced the building time to 2 months per ship. And in one incredible display of American ingenuity and workmanship, he built a complete Liberty ship ready for commission in 4 days. What Henry J. Kaiser and others found was that the planning and pursuit of parallel activities enabled huge tasks to be completed in a fraction of the time that would be required if each task was only started after an earlier task had been completed. Finally, there are sequential activities. These are activities that depend upon each other. One cannot be done before the other is finished. It is almost always sequential activities that determine how fast you can finish a job, initiate a strategy, achieve a goal, or accomplish a final objective. Identify the key sequential activities in your project planning and make sure that you get started on them early enough so that they do not hold up completion of the entire task. Step 5. The final letter in GOSPA, A, stands for activities. These are the tasks that have to be completed to fulfill the plans. Your job, either managing yourself or managing others, is to be absolutely clear about the specific activities that need to be done every day to carry out the strategy. In working with others, practice management by objectives. Take the time to explain, discuss, and agree on the job or jobs to be done. Make sure that everyone knows how he or she will be measured and when the tasks are supposed to be completed. Encourage people to report to you if they are behind schedule. Keep in regular touch with them to make sure that they are accomplishing the required objectives as agreed. Another way to manage activities is to practice management by responsibility. You can use this method with people whom you know and trust and who have demonstrated a certain level of proven competence. To get the most out of this method, you should delegate both authority and responsibility for the completion of the task. Set deadlines and sub-deadlines so that the other person knows when the task is expected. Be available to help and support the other person if he runs into any problems or obstructions. Finally, when you manage by objectives or manage by responsibility, remember that delegation is not abdication. Always inspect what you expect. The more vital the task is to the final objective, the more important it is that you stay on top of it. Never assume that things will get done without your regular and continued intervention and involvement. Like a doctor with a critically ill patient, you should make regular spot checks on your key staff to make sure that everything is on track and on schedule. Business objectives are market objectives. In business, all strategic planning is market planning. The customer is not only king, the customer must be the center point of all thinking and planning in the setting and achieving of business goals. What the customer wants, what the customer needs, what the customer likes, what the customer dislikes, what the customer will pay for, what the customer is being offered by your competitors, are the critical factors that determine profits or losses, success or failure, and especially in tough competitive markets. As Dun & Bradstreet concluded after 50 years of studying businesses of all kinds, the entirety of business wisdom can be summarized in one statement. Businesses succeed because of high sales. Businesses fail because of low sales. All else is commentary. Having built, run, or managed 22 different companies, my philosophy has always been to concentrate on sales. Whenever you have financial problems of any kind, think exclusively in terms of making more sales and generating more revenues. Cash flow is king. The ability to generate the top line is the decisive ability in modern business. In a recent survey, corporate executives were asked, "How important are sales to your organization?" Virtually every executive replied that sales were extremely important, if not the most important element in their businesses. The executives were then asked, "How much of your time do you spend on sales and marketing-related activities?" The average amount of time spent by business owners and executives turned out to be approximately 11%. All the rest was consumed by non-sales activities. A business cannot cost-cut or save its way to success. The only way to survive and thrive in any market is to focus intensively and exclusively on producing and selling products and services that people are willing to buy and pay for and that make a profit for the company. Sales strategy analysis. In strategic planning for organizations, consider the core questions in sales and marketing. What is to be sold? To whom? And by whom? And how? And at what price? And how is it to be delivered and paid for? The failure to ask and answer these questions accurately is the primary cause for declining revenues and cash flow, and often the failure of the enterprise. The ability to ask and answer these questions correctly is the primary reason for business success. Here are the key questions that a salesperson, business owner, or sales executive must ask and answer repeatedly. Number one, who is our customer? Define your ideal customer in terms of age, education, income, position, tastes, experience, background, and psychology. What are the trends? Who will be your customers of tomorrow? What do you need to do to make your products and services more appealing to your ideal customer? Question 2. What does my customer consider value? What is your customer willing to pay for in a competitive market? What benefits does she expect to get from doing business with you? Of all the benefits that you offer, what is the most important benefit that the customer must be convinced that she will receive before she will make a buying decision? If you don't know the answer to this question, you need to go back to the drawing board. Number 3, who are my competitors? What are all the different businesses or alternative uses for the same money that compete with you? Since customers can only purchase a limited number of products or services, who else is trying to acquire your same customer, and what are they doing differently from you? Question 4, why do my prospective customers buy from my competitors? What benefits do they perceive in dealing with my competitors? What is it that they like about my competitors that causes them to prefer my competitors' offerings to my offerings? Question 5, what is my competitive advantage? What is it that we do better than anyone else? What is our unique selling proposition? Every successful business is built around a unique competitive advantage that no other competitor can offer. What is yours? What should it be? What could it be? This is a key question for business success. Question 6. What do we need to do differently to attract more customers in the future? Remember, whatever got you to where you are today is not enough to keep you there. What do you have to do better, faster, or cheaper to win the customers of tomorrow away from your competitors? Your ability to answer this question accurately determines your business future. 7. What is your value offering? If past customers were to be interviewed, what would they say about you? How would they describe you? What words would they use to describe your products or services or their experiences in dealing with you? Most important, how could you influence your customers of the future so that they think and talk about you in the way that would be most helpful to you in a competitive marketplace? Sales are the lifeblood of the business. Nothing happens until a sale takes place. Whatever your position in your business, you are still in sales. Everything that you do contributes either to the making of a sale or to the fulfilling of a sale. The greater the impact you can have on sales and profitability, the more valuable you become. And the more you think about marketing, sales, and profitability, the more likely it is that you will do the critical things that improve those functions in your organization. Personal strategic planning. The principle of the objective in military terms is to seize critical positions, take ground, and win battles and wars. The principle of the objective applied to businesses to create and keep customers, to make profits, and to thrive in a competitive marketplace. The principle of the objective in personal terms refers to your ability to decide exactly what you really want in life, to make plans to achieve your goals, and then to carry out your plans in a timely fashion. Your ability to set goals for yourself is the master skill of success. People who set clear goals for themselves and who know exactly what they want always accomplish vastly more and accomplish it faster than people who are not sure who they are or where they are going. The very act of setting goals transforms your life and virtually guarantees your future. In goal setting, you always begin with the process of idealization. In study after study of high-performing men and women, the most successful people allow themselves to dream on a regular basis. They project forward 5 and 10 years into the future and imagine what their perfect lives would look like if they were to achieve all their goals. Imagine that you could get into a time machine and, in the blink of an eye, arrive at a point 5 years in the future. When you opened your eyes, something miraculous has happened. Your life is perfect in every way. Every part of your home, family, and work life is ideal in every respect. Here's the question. What does it look like? If your life were perfect in every way, what would it look like? This ability to define and describe your perfect future life is the key to setting goals for yourself in the present. Once you've defined your ideal perfect life, ask yourself, what would have to happen for this perfect life to become a reality? I like to call this thinking in the past perfect future subjunctive. It's the highest form of speculative and creative thinking, and it is the key to designing your own future. Look around you in the present and practice idealization as well. Decide what you really want before you start thinking about all the reasons why it may not be possible. Imagine that you could wave a magic wand and be, do, and have everything and anything you wanted without limitation. What goals would you set for yourself? Imagine that you had free...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.